An understanding of the determinants of cardiac output is essential to both medical specialists in their dealing with heart disease and hypertension, and to surgical specialists who deal with shock states and the maintenance of adequate circulation during surgical procedures. In this program, I'll introduce you to some fundamental yet often misunderstood concepts about the determinants of cardiac output by examining this hydraulic model of the cardiovascular system. A model gives us a unique opportunity to directly observe phenomena that we can measure only indirectly in the human body. Any model is potentially as useful as its ability to replicate the body's response to identical stimuli. As you will see during the program, this model will mimic physiologic responses very well because of a special component, the pump. The pump is a homolog of the heart. Each of the two pumps has a ventricle, an inlet, and an outlet valve, and an atrium. The left pump is connected to a simulated aorta through which fluid flows to systemic arterioles and a distensible capillary bed, which empties into venules, a vena cava, and back to the right heart pump. The pulmonary circuit has a pulmonary artery, arterioles, a compliant capillary bed emptying into simulated venules, and pulmonary veins back to the left pump. At this point, the systemic and pulmonary circuits cross, making this system a single circuit with the two pumps in series, just like in the human cardiovascular system. As previously stated, the most significant characteristic of the model and the one that allows it to reproduce cardiovascular phenomena is the pump. These pumps, unlike most, do not suck at their inlets to fill. Let's compare this non-sucking pump to one that does suck to fill. This is a standard roller pump commonly used in cardiopulmonary bypass. The rollers compress the tubing to push fluid forward. The tubing recoils to its original shape behind the roller, thereby generating suction that refills the tubing with fluid. Since the tubing is always full because of the suction, the output is determined by the speed of the pump. Pump output is therefore equal to stroke rate times stroke volume. That is, the speed of the pump times the volume of fluid between the rollers. This pump therefore not only moves the fluid, but determines the flow rate by virtue of pump speed. External or systemic factors such as increase in hydrostatic pressure generated by lifting the fluid container above the level of the pump do not alter the pump output. In contrast, this non-sucking pump has a ventricle that is normally flat instead of round on cross-section. After this ventricle is compressed, it does not rebound and suck as in the other pump. It fills passively after being emptied. If I turn the pump on at a rate of 80 beats per minute, you can see that there is no flow. Even if I increase the rate above 80 beats a minute and increase the strength of driving force of the impellers by hand cranking the pump, there is no output. The pressure in the system is below pump level. Since the pump cannot suck to fill, no fluid runs into the ventricles, so there can be no output. It is only when the bottle is raised above pump level that flow occurs. Therefore, flow in a non-sucking pump is controlled by the amount of pressure in the system. Increasing the pressure increases the flow. Decreasing the pressure decreases the flow. So the output of a sucking pump is controlled by pump factors, whereas the output of a non-sucking pump is controlled by systemic factors. Now let's go back to the model and see what this non-sucking pump does in that system. With ventricular capacity of 100 cc's, these pumps are capable of pumping 8 liters a minute at the current rate of 80 beats a minute. Yet no circulation is occurring. Increasing the pump rate and strength of contraction by hand cranking also affects no flow. But remember, We just observed that non-sucking pumps cannot pump without there being pressure in the system. You can see that the compliant beds are flaccid, so perhaps there's insufficient pressure in the system. A U-tube connected to the arteries allows me to confirm that the pressure in the system is below pump level. This black line being equal to the pump level and the green fluid equal to the system pressure. The pressure is low because of the low volume of fluid in the system. The model is in hypovolemic shock. Just as in the human with inadequate pressure in the cardiovascular system from low fluid volume, increasing the heart rate or strength of contraction does not improve cardiac output. I can increase the fluid volume in this system through this intravascular line. I'll add 250 cc's of fluid and see if that's enough to promote flow. As you can see, this amount of fluid did not increase the flow. And correspondingly, that amount of fluid did not fill this flaccid system to a level above the pump level. Therefore, if that was an inadequate amount, we'll add 250 cc's more and see if that will start the flow. That did cause some flow. So we now have 1.5 liters a minute flow. Correspondingly, the pressure within the system is now above pump level. If a small amount of fluid caused that amount of flow, let's see what an additional 250 cc's will do. This additional 250 cc's caused a marked difference in flow. As you can see, we now have 4 liters a minute. With this increased flow, we also observe that the pressure in the system is now much higher than it was before. We have now seen a significant increase in flow. So what we have seen is that increase in fluid volume in the vascular system increases the output. Although the increase was not linear, since the 250 cc's I put in last changed the flow rate much more than the 500 cc's that was put in during the first two transfusions.